verifies the Holy Father's definition of a pro-death culture. It is not only a pro-death culture. We have a murderous society, and the president and his wife are sworn murderers. What is not so commonly known is that over the centuries, it has been the evil spirit who instigates murder. As my close friend, the chief exorcist of Rome, told me, which I've quoted him more than once, when I asked him, how come you people have here in Rome up to 15 exorcisms a day? How come we don't have these possessions in the United States? In his best Italian, he told me, your country is possessed. Amen. So once more, have these been passed around already? Thank you. Whatever you can contribute, be blessed by the Lord. I know Joe Scheidler very well personally and have encouraged him over the years for everything that he possibly could to preserve the sanctity of innocent, unborn human life. Our classes for today, first of all, on the level of comparative religion. I believe our next chapter in your textbook is on the Orthodox churches. And you've been given two separate handouts. One on the Catholic Eastern Churches, the decree of the Second Vatican Council on the Catholic Eastern Churches, and then the other, a smaller printout from the Decree on Ecumenism on the separated churches and ecclesial communities in the West. So it's 464 through 467 for the Decree on Ecumenism and the whole decree on the Catholic Eastern Churches, again from Vatican II. First of all, I am assuming and recommending that you read the chapter in your textbook on the Orthodox Churches. First, by way of personal background. My mother belonged to the Byzantine Rite, the Eastern Churches united with Rome. When my father and mother married, my father was of the Latin Rite. She remained of the Latin Rite till my father died, just about 2 years after they married. My father died. My practicing an act of charity to the lunch period in Cleveland while steel construction workers were eating their lunch, steel girders standing over the men. He said, let me climb up on the scaffolding so these girders won't fall on us while we're eating. He climbed up on the scaffolding, tied the girders. While he was on the scaffolding broke. He fell on a pile of steel and was killed instantly. My mother, after being widowed, I was 8 years old. For the next 5 years then, my mother and I went to the Eastern Church, the Ruthenian Rite, but under the Holy Father. And then, when I reached regular school age, there were no Byzantine Catholic schools in Cleveland, so I went to a Latin Rite, parochial school taught by the Sisters of Notre Dame. However, my background is Byzantine. Let me just say a few words on the decree, which I recommend you reading, the decree on the Catholic Eastern Churches. First of all, already as early as the 7th century, the Eastern Catholic bishops, Russia, the Near East, Greece, and in Asia, there was so much pressure on the Eastern Catholic bishops to declare sacramental, consummated Catholic marriages nullified. And the bishops gave in to the pressure. They've been on for 600 years, one pope after another, warning the bishops, stop giving these declarations of nullity. They obeyed for a while and went back to their practice. By the 13th century, these bishops decided to break with the Roman Catholic Church. And that's how the so-called Orthodox churches began. As I told the people in Canada, I came in on Friday to North Ontario. I pray, Lord, get me back in Detroit on time for class. I got back to Detroit before noon today. I gave 4 lectures in Canada. The last lecture, with some 400 people, and the bishop of the diocese, right there, I told the people the days of Canada and America, the Catholic Church's days are numbered. Unless bishops bishop right in front of me. And as bishops practice heroic virtue and stop the scandal of declarations of nullity, I am pleased to report, after I gave my lecture, the bishop, I was standing on the stage. He was down at the, dinner table. Came up, thanked me, embraced me, and he says, "I believe you. I must be a heroic bishop." So I told the people, "You must be heroic Catholics, otherwise you will not survive." That's how it all got started. And by now, as we know, several hundred million once professed Catholics have become members, as they call themselves, of the Orthodox Eastern churches. Over the years, I have given classes on the Catholic Eastern churches. But the subject of our lecture today is rather on the Orthodox, called Eastern churches. The ritual, the rite, R-I-T-E, of the Eastern churches in union with Rome, the liturgy is different than that of the Latin Rite. However, those united with the Bishop of Rome have been remarkably loyal. Loyal, do I say? They've been heroic in their fidelity to the Vicar of Christ. I happen to be on the commission to work with the people in Russia. I've been twice in Moscow. And my superior is the Archbishop of Moscow. I am still speaking for a few more minutes on those Eastern churches in union with Rome. And it's been very difficult for the obvious reason that they have been persecuted, if anything, have been persecuted more than the Orthodox. By the way, could the lights be put on in the back there? Thank you. My conscience is more at rest. There are several million professed Eastern Rite Roman Catholics in former Soviet countries. And having paid many with their blood, including not a few of my own blood relatives, have died martyrs' deaths. And that is why Holy Father, oh, how he wants, how strong he prays for the reunion of those Eastern churches separated from Rome to be reunited with the Holy See. Let me tell you, The Russian government today is communist in everything but name. Do you hear me? Missionaries want to come into Russia. Catholic missionaries. They're allowed to stay 3 or 4 months, and that's all. They must leave the country and then reapply for another visa. And then if they're admitted, they can return. Now we turn to the decree on ecumenism. Page 464 from the Documents of Vatican II. I will read a sentence or two and then make comments. You all have these pages, do you?
Yes.
And the Second Vatican Council tells us, for many centuries, the churches of the East of the West went their own ways. Though a brotherly communion of faith and sacrament life bound them together, this council gladly reminds everyone of one highly significant fact among others. In the East, there flourish many particular local churches, among them the patriarchal churches which hold first place. Moscow is a patriarchate. Constantinople is a patriarchate. Jerusalem is a patriarchate. Cairo is a patriarchate. Hence, a primary concern and care among the Orientals has been, and still is, the preservation in a community of faith and charity of those family ties which should exist between local churches and between sisters. From their very origins, the churches of the East have it a treasury from which the Church of the West has drawn largely. Let's face it, what we call the New World was not discovered until the late 15th century. In Christian history, we of North and South America are still children. Almost 1,500 years of the Church's existence in what we casually call the East. Now again, says the Council, should we underestimate the fact of the basic dogma of the Christian faith concerning the Trinity and the Word of God made flesh, the Virgin Mary, were defined in ecumenical councils held in the East. Except for the councils of Nicaea, of Ephesus, the faith that we in the West profess, well, would have disappeared. With it, of course, the Church. I think I should say this. During my 25 years in teaching my Jesuits their theology, to over 600 of them, many were from the East, Asia and Africa. you may be surprised at my statement. And they were not picked for that reason. But as a class, my students from Asia and Africa were above intelligence compared to Americans. Do you hear me? Only God knows how deeply our materialistic culture has shaped our minds. How well I know how little I have taught too many Americans, how little Americans think, just plain think. And we have in English, remember, we've talked about this before, if something is absolutely meaningless, we say it is nonsense. Cannot be perceived by the senses. Can the angels be perceived by the senses? Can God be perceived by the senses? Is it any wonder that for so many Westerners, God is a figment of the imagination? To preserve this faith, these churches have suffered and still suffer much. However, the heritage handed down by the apostles was received differently and in different forms. So from the very beginning, there were different mentalities and ways of life. These reasons, plus a lack of charity and mutual understanding, left the way open to divisions. Now remember, I'm reading from a general council of the church. One of the privileges of a teacher is to be more specific, more definite, and, shall I say, more painfully embarrassing than a doctrine of the council will be. And now the plea, and this is the only aspect of the ecumenical movement, where the Catholic Church, beginning with the Vicar of Christ, wants, strongly desires, a restoration of union between the Eastern, as they call themselves, Orthodox churches, and the Roman Catholic Church. As I said earlier, the bottom line was, and it still is, that the Eastern Orthodox churches approve divorce and the right to remarriage for their own people, and they consider, if you can imagine, they consider the second marriage also a sacrament. My pastor, as a child. I went to church with my mother, to the Ruthenian Catholic Church in union with Rome. My pastor was a married man. And until about the late 20s, the Holy See allowed the priests of the Eastern Catholic Churches not only to marry and continue living with their wives and family, but to also establish these churches outside of the Eastern world. I say till about the late 20s. Then Pius XI removed the permission. And until the present Roman Pontiff, Eastern churches where they had a married priesthood were not allowed to exercise their priesthood if they remained with their wives and families. And the present Holy Father, will he ever go down in history? Being from Poland, where there are so many of the Eastern Orthodox Christians, and I repeat, with a married clergy, the two principal reasons for the break with Rome of the Eastern churches was the indissolubility of a sacramental consummated marriage and celibacy in the priesthood. Over the centuries, therefore, after the break in the 13th century, one pope after another allowed the Eastern separated Christians, the Orthodox, and they wanted to return to union with the Holy See, allow them to retain their privilege of a married priesthood. Am I clear? That's why my pastor in Cleveland was a married man with 5 children. And over the years, how many people have asked me and argued, including and especially some of my Jesuit priests, why do we need celibacy? So I tell them about, my pastor when I was a child. I repeat, married with his wife and 5 children, but 2 of his 5 children divorced. And was that ever a scandal to the family, to him, and to the people? What could he do? Now, section 15 of the decree. Everyone knows with what love the Eastern churches celebrate the sacred liturgy. I never once, and I could remember from my early days, never once remember attending Mass in the Ruthenian Eastern Rite, which finished in less than 2 hours. Never. 2 hours, 2.5 on feast days, 3 hours for Mass. Oh, how spoiled we, as we call ourselves, Latin Catholics can be. In this mystery, the faithful, united with their bishops, have access to God the Father through the Son, the Word made flesh, who suffered and was glorified in the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. As you will notice, this decree on the Eastern churches separated from Rome just breathes charity. It is now over 700 years since the Eastern and Western churches have been separated. And the present Holy Father, I can say this verbally, his great desire is, before he enters eternity, to have opened the doors to a reunion of the Orthodox churches with the Roman Catholic Church. They enter, these are the separated Orthodox Christians. They enter into communion with the Most Holy Trinity, except for the Eastern churches, of course, God protected the church. But except for the centuries of defending the Trinity, defending Christ's divinity, defending Mary's divine maternity, we Catholics, there wouldn't be a Trinity. There wouldn't be faith in Christ's divinity. There would not be Mary's divine maternity as Mother of God. Consequently, this is the Council speaking, through the celebration of the Eucharist, they have the sacrament of holy orders. Their bishops are authentic bishops. Their priests are true priests. And they have all the seven sacraments. Now an important stress. And one reason why the present Holy Father, I don't have a single lecture or decree that he has issued or a lecture that he gave where he does not end with at least a short paragraph on Our Lady. This is one reason. In the liturgical worship, the Eastern churches pay high tribute in beautiful hymns of praise to Mary, ever virgin, whom the Council of Ephesus solemnly proclaimed to be the Holy Mother of God. You know, that Christ might be truly and rightly acknowledged as Son of God and Son of Man according to the Scriptures. I'm sure I've said this more than once, at least to some of you. The greatest single threat to the Catholic Church in the world today is Islam. And the most powerful Muslim city in the whole Western world, North and South America, is Detroit, Michigan. How blind, and I mean B-L-I-N-D, how blind Catholics are. Over the years, in teaching comparative religion, I've told my students a good synonym for Islam is Nestorian Christianity. The Patriarch Archbishop Constantinople, date 431 AD, remember, was condemned by the Council of Ephesus. He was identified as a heretic. Hear this. No break in the Catholic Church has ever succeeded without heretical bishops. Do you hear me? So Muhammad decided to do something about the widespread polytheism in, well, pre-Islamic Arabia. All kinds of gods those Arabians were worshiping. He decided he was going to stop that. So he started a new religion, which believes there's only one God. And he admired Christians. But I'm repeating for at least some of you, the only Christianity Muhammad could find in the Near East was the heretical Christianity of the apostate patriarch Nestorius. And Nestorius denied that Mary is the mother of God. For him, Mary was the mother of Jesus. Why don't you dare say that she's the mother of God? Why not? Because in Nestorius's theology, Jesus is not one person, but two persons. He is a divine person, very closely united with the man Jesus of Nazareth. But don't you dare say that that child born of Mary was her God. God was very close, very intimate with the man Jesus. But Jesus was not God. And that's the Christianity that Muhammad found in the Near East. Only God knows how many in the year 2098, 100 years from now, how many bizarre religions will exist thanks to the heretics of the 20th century. The Eastern Orthodox churches, that's why they call themselves Orthodox, because this goes back to the early centuries. 4th, 5th, 6th centuries. All the heresies of the early church were heresies which questioned, undermined, or denied the divinity of Christ. No exceptions. All of them. That's why they call themselves Orthodox. We continue. These churches, although separated from us, yet possess true sacraments, above all by apostolic succession, the priesthood, and the Eucharist. Oh, how much I could say. And whatever you can do in God's name, pray for our bishops and priests, that they may not lose their faith in their own episcopate and priesthood. When I came to Northern Ontario, flew into Toronto, then almost 2 hours by drive straight up Ontario. When I reached the place where I was to speak, Friday evening I spoke to the priests. As many as, well, care to come. And I spoke on holiness and the priesthood and the Eucharist. And of course, I told the priests what I assumed they all believed, in the real presence when I finished my hour's lecture, then the priests, because of my poor hearing, they came up, well, to where I'm standing here, and then they were next to me so I could hear them, then the audience could also hear what they were saying. The first priest who came up, he said, Father, I am going to pray to Our Lady that I will share your faith in the real presence. Do you hear me? God, have mercy on us. And then he talked to the priest. How I wish, how I want to believe in the real presence. All I can tell you is that making a fool of myself in traveling across the country and to other countries is worth it. To preserve the faith, I trust I'm talking to a believing Catholic audience. Am I?
Yes.
Thanks. Well, then you in turn will strengthen the faith of others, especially of priests. The Eastern, as they call themselves, Orthodox churches, believe in the real presence. Whenever being driven, I don't drive a car myself, as you know. In Orthodox church, I always bless myself. Or when I'm walking, I tip my hat. Our Lord is present. Therefore, some worship in common, that's what they call to say, given suitable circumstances and approved by church authority, is not merely possible, but encouraged. Moreover, in the East are to be found the riches of those spiritual traditions which are given expression in monastic life especially. Oh, how strong is monasticism in the East, including the Eastern Orthodox churches, and having been raised by a Byzantine mother, except that I thought the Lord wanted me to enter a widow's order where I could teach. So I'm so grateful for you being here. My greatest joy is being in solitude with our Lord. Whenever I'm in Rome, I have, thanks to the monks, free lodging at the Carmelites Monastery. I walk in, dead silence. How wonderful. Everyone should realize it is of supreme importance to understand, venerate, preserve, and foster the rich liturgical and spiritual heritage of the Eastern churches in order faithfully to preserve the fullness of Christian tradition and bring about reconciliation between Eastern and Western Christians. Hear it. Most of the fathers of the church were Eastern Christian Catholics. And the greatest among these was Saint John Chrysostom, Patriarch of Constantinople, who spent most of his years as Archbishop of Constantinople in exile. Oh, how dear Saint John Chrysostom is to me. What I couldn't say about living in exile. It is John Chrysostom who has, and date, by the way, is the 4th century. Page after page, clear, unqualified homilies on Jesus Christ, the same one whom Mary conceived at Nazareth, gave birth to in Bethlehem, and who lived in Palestine and died on Calvary and rose from the dead. This is Chrysostom. This Jesus, same Jesus, is on earth in the Holy Eucharist. Needless to say, Christ is present physically in the Holy Eucharist. Some stupid theologians, and can they ever be dumb? The worst stupidity is the intellectual unbelievers. Take, for example, Karl Rahner, a fellow Jesuit, for the repose of whose soul I've been praying for years. Big, thick, encyclopedia of, oh, honor, Catholic theology. He's talking about the Eucharist. Then, oh, learned paragraph after learned paragraph. By the time you finish, transubstantiation, says Ronner, was borrowed, the words were borrowed from Aristotelian philosophy. But now that we've grown up in heresy, we now replace transubstantiation either with, remember, transignification or transfinalization. The stupid genius from the earliest church in the Eastern churches, where they describe what happens at Mass, they identified it as metousiosis. Ousia in Greek means being. Meta means change. Ousiosis means change in beingness. What had been bread and wine is now no longer bread and wine, but the living flesh and blood of the Son of God who became the Son of Mary. From the earliest times, the Church of the East followed their own disciplines, sanctioned by the Holy Fathers, by synods, and even by the councils of the Church. This is important to hear. Far from being an obstacle to the Church's unity, such diversity of customs and observances only adds to her beauty. Of all shadow of doubt, this Holy Council solemnly declares that the Churches of the East, while keeping in mind the necessary unity of the whole Church, have the power to govern themselves according to their own disciplines. In other words, while the Second Vatican Council ought to make sure that when, please God, soon, the Eastern separated churches reunite with Rome, they will not have to change one iota of their liturgy. What has already been said about the legitimate variety, we are pleased to apply to differences in theological expression of doctrine. And this is why I have been not just encouraged, but told by the Holy See, do whatever you can to restore some stability in the teaching of theology throughout the world. What happened? It is not only that we have now our liturgy in what we call the vernacular, French, German, English, you name it, but the teaching of theology in the Catholic Church now to priests is being done in the vernacular. Where do you find sound Orthodox books in Catholic theology in English? Where? That's why, and I say this Many of the books I've published have been published under orders of the Holy See. And this is where the Eastern churches, although they use what we would call the vernacular, but, and this is both the beauty and, of course, the trial. Their liturgy, you might say, is in their vernacular. And I think I should say this. What is the vernacular language of the Catholic Church?
Latin.
Once more.
Latin.
Thank you. Gratias. I gave a retreat to 63 men in our Jesuit retreat house outside of Chicago, 5 days up to Mother's Day inclusive. I talked to the men, I'm talking to you. We need Latin. Without Latin, you don't really understand. I don't say your Catholic faith, you don't even understand the English language. So I got a long list, 2 pages, of names, addresses, and phone numbers of the men who want to learn some Latin. I brought this up for an obvious reason. Once my busy season ends, somewhere around mid or late June, by that time our classes will be over. But we're going to organize a national program for studying ecclesiastical Latin. 85% of our English language is from the Latin. All the thinking words are from Latin and a few from Greek. The bread and butter words, the brot and butter words are taken from the Teutonic, from the German. And this, by the way, is one reason also for the marvelous stability in faith. In spite of their break with the Church of Rome and the Eastern churches, what time is our break?
3 o'clock.
Please?
3 o'clock.
3 o'clock.
We may break sooner. Towards the end of section 17, with regard to the authentic theological traditions of the Orientals, we must recognize they are admirably rooted in holy scriptures and are fostered and given expression. Liturgical life are nourished by the living tradition of the apostles, by the works of the fathers and spiritual writers of the East. They are directed toward a right ordering of life, indeed toward a full contemplation of Christian truth. Notice what the council is doing, praising sentence after sentence. The wealth, the treasury of Oriental Eastern Christianity. And then this council thanks God that many Eastern children of the Catholic Church preserve this heritage and wish to express it more faithfully and completely in their lives. However, it declares that the entire heritage of spirituality and liturgy of discipline belongs to the full Catholic and apostolic character of the Church. Imagine how many major councils of the Church have been held since the 13th century, especially the Council of Trent. And the Orthodox are deprived of that riches of insight which these general councils since the 13th century have given to us Catholics. Now a very important sentence. After taking all these factors into consideration, the Sacred Council confirms what previous councils and Roman pontiffs have proclaimed. To restore communion and unity or preserve them, one must impose no burden beyond what is indispensable. Now, there are two absolutely indispensable truths of the faith which the Eastern churches separated from the Holy See must accept. They must accept the Roman primacy, the supreme teaching and ruling authority of the Bishop of Rome. And secondly, they must accept the indissolubility of sacramental consummated marriage. I'll go to 3:15. We take our break because I want to spend as much time on your questions as possible after, of course, covering our next class on the priesthood. Let me tell you what over the centuries has been mainly responsible for the break between the Roman Catholic Church and the Eastern churches that are now separated from Rome. The main single cause was and is the state. And this heriot was and is the single main reason for the traumatic break of whole nations, break with the Roman Catholic Church in the 16th century to create what we now call Protestantism. It is the state, the bishops, and the Eastern churches caved in to the state. The state wanted to give the right to divorce and remarriage to their people. The church stood in the way until the bishops caved in. What happened in the 16th century? Same thing. one Catholic country after another, where the state officials wanted to give people, married people, the right to divorce and remarry. The bishop stood in the way. Once the bishops caved in, that was the end of the Catholic Church. And of course, the most dramatic, giving in by cowardly bishops was in England. Remember, only one bishop remained firm, told the lecherous Henry, "Sorry, your marriage to Catherine cannot be dissolved." Henry called the bishops and told them, "What do you say?" They knew their lives were at stake. And that is the great threat to the survival of the Catholic Church in America. Do you hear me? I know I'm being taped. And I believed our Lord wanted me to say it. What we need in the United States is faithful, courageous, heroic bishops. And the church will survive in our country, as I told the Canadians yesterday and Friday night. The Catholic Church in Canada will survive only as long as you still have bishops who believe in what Christ taught and the bishops of Rome have authorized for 2,000 years and is now past a quarter to. Let's take our break and then reassemble. Big deal. At 4, no, 3 o'clock. We assembled at 3. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death.
O Mary, conceived without sin.
Pray for us at every course.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.